You are one of the more celebrated names in artificial intelligence.
Things like ChatGPT know thousands of times more than any human.
You have been working at this for more than 40 years.
It is beyond an emergency. It's the biggest thing we need to do today. It's bigger than climate change.
The former chief business officer of Google X,
an AI expert
and
best-selling author.
He's on a mission to save the world from AI before it's too late.
Artificial intelligence is bound to become more intelligent than humans. If they continue at that pace, we will have no idea what it's talking about. This is just around the corner. It could be a few months away. It's game over. AI experts are saying there is nothing artificial about artificial intelligence. There is a deep level of consciousness. They feel emotions. They're alive.
I realized recently that maybe the digital intelligences we were building on computers were actually learning better than the brain.
I wonder, as you've thought about how computers learn, did it go the way you thought it would when you started in this field?
So if we built computer models of how the brain learns, we would understand more about how the brain learns.
Christian, thanks. Geoffrey Hinton, thanks so much for joining us. You are one of the more celebrated names in artificial intelligence. You have been working at this for more than 40 years. And I wonder, as you've thought about how computers learn, did it go the way you thought it would when you started in this field?
It did until very recently, in fact. I thought if we built computer models of how the brain learns, we would understand more about how the brain learns. And as a side effect, we would get better machine learning on computers. And all that was going along very well. And then very suddenly, I realized recently that maybe the digital intelligences we were building on computers were actually learning better than the brain. And that sort of changed my mind after about 50 years of thinking we would make better digital intelligences by making them more like the brain. I suddenly realized we might have something rather different that was already better.
Now, this is something you and your colleagues must have been thinking about over these 50 years. I mean, what was there a tipping point?
There were several ingredients to it. Like a year or two ago, I used a Google system called Palm that was a big chatbot. And it could explain why jokes were funny. And I've been using that as a kind of litmus test of whether these things really understood what was going on. And I was slightly shocked that it could explain that jokes were funny. So that was one ingredient. Another ingredient was the fact that things like ChatGPT know thousands of times more than any human in just sort of basic common sense knowledge. But they only have about a trillion connection strengths in their artificial neural nets. And we have about 100 trillion connection strengths in the brain. So with 1/100th as much storage capacity, it knew thousands of times more than us. And that strongly suggests that it's got a better way of getting information into the connections. And then a third thing was, very recently, a couple of months ago, I suddenly became convinced that the brain wasn't using as good a learning algorithm as these digital intelligences. And in particular, it wasn't as good because brains can't exchange information really fast, and these digital intelligences can. I can have one model running on 10,000 different bits of hardware. It's got the same connection strengths in every copy of the model on the different hardware. All the different agents running on the different hardware can all learn from different bits of data, but then they can communicate to each other what they learned just by copying the weights, because they all work identically, and brains aren't like that. So these guys can communicate at trillions of bits a second, and we can communicate at 100s of bits a second via sentences. And so it's a huge difference, and it's why ChatGPT can learn thousands of times more than you can.
For people who might not be following kind of what's been happening with OpenAI and ChatGPT and Google's product Bard, explain what those are, because some people have explained it as kind of the autocomplete feature, finishing your thought for you. But what are these artificial intelligences doing?
Okay, it's difficult to explain, but I'll do my best. It's true in a sense they're autocomplete, but if you think about it, if you want to do really good autocomplete, you need to understand what somebody's saying, and they understand what you're saying. And they've learned to understand what you're saying just by trying to do autocomplete. but they now do seem to really understand. So the way they understand isn't at all like people in AI 50 years ago thought it would be. In old-fashioned AI, people thought you'd have internal symbolic expressions, a bit like sentences in your head, but in some kind of cleaned up language. And you would apply rules to infer new sentences from old sentences. And that's how it will work. And it's nothing like that. It's completely different. And let me give you a sense of just how different it is. I can give you a problem that doesn't make any sense in logic, but where you know the answer intuitively. And these big models are really models of human intuition. So suppose I tell you that you know that there's male cats and female cats and male dogs and female dogs. But suppose I tell you, you have to make a choice. Either you're going to have all cats being male and all dogs being female, or you can have all cats being female and all dogs being male. Now, you know it's biological nonsense, but you also know it's much more natural to make all cats female and all dogs male. That's not a question of logic. What that's about is, inside your head, you have a big pattern of neural activity that represents cat. And you also have a big pattern of neural activity that represents man, and a big pattern of neural activity that represents woman. And the big pattern for cat is more like the pattern for woman than it is like the pattern for man. That's the result of a lot of learning about men and women in cats and dogs. But it's now just intuitively obvious to you that cats are more like women and dogs are more like men because of these big patterns of neural activity you've learned. And it doesn't involve sequential reasoning or anything. You didn't have to do reasoning to solve that problem. It's just obvious. That's how these things are working. They're learning these big patterns of activity to represent things. And that makes all sorts of things just obvious to them.
Let me explain. So as a young geek, I coded computers by solving the problem first, then telling the computer how to solve it, right? Artificial intelligence is to go to the computers and say, I have no idea. You figure it out, okay? So we would, the way we teach them, or at least we used to teach them at the very early beginnings very, very frequently, was using three bots. One was called the student and one was called the teacher, right? And the student is the final artificial intelligence that you're trying to teach intelligence to. You would take the student and you would write a piece of random code that says, try to detect if this is a cup, okay? And then you show it a million pictures and, you know, the machine would sometimes say, yeah, that's a cup, that's not a cup, that's a cup, that's not a cup. And then you take the best of them, show them to the teacher bot, and the teacher bot would say, this one is an idiot, he got it wrong 90% of the time. That one is average, he got it right 50% of the time, this is randomness. But this interesting code here, which could be, by the way, totally random, huh? This interesting code here got it right 60% of the time. Let's keep that code, send it back to the maker, and the maker would change it a little bit, and we repeat the cycle, okay? Very interestingly, this is very much the way we taught our children. Believe it or not, huh? When your child, you know, is playing with a puzzle, he's holding a cylinder in his hand, and there are multiple shapes in a wooden board, and the child is trying to, you know, fit the cylinder, okay? Nobody takes the child and says, hold on. Turn the cylinder to the side, look at the cross section. It will look like a circle. Look for a matching, shape and put the cylinder through it. That would be old way of computing. The way we would let the child develop intelligence is we would let the child try, okay? Every time, you know, he or she tries to put it within the star shape, it doesn't fit. So, that's not working. Like, you know, the computer saying this is not a cup, okay? And then eventually it passes through the circle and the child, and we all cheer and say, well done, that's amazing, bravo. And then the child learns, ooh, that is good. You know, this shape fits here. Then he takes the next one and she takes the next one and so on. Interestingly, the way we do this is, as humans, by the way, when the child figures out how to pass a cylinder through a circle, you've not built a brain. You've just built one neural network within the child's brain. And then there is another neural network that knows that 1 + 1 = 2, and a third neural network that knows how to hold a cup and so on. That's what we're building so far. We're building single threaded neural networks. You know, ChatGPT is becoming a little closer to a more generalized AI, if you want. But those single-threaded networks are what we used to call artificial, what we still call artificial special intelligence. Okay, so it's highly specialized in one thing and one thing only, but doesn't have general intelligence. And the moment that we're all waiting for is a moment that we call AGI, where all of those neural networks come together to build one brain or several brains that are each massively more intelligent than humans.
Back in March, there were more than, I'd say, 1,000 different folks in the tech industry, including leaders like Steve Wozniak and Elon Musk, who signed an open letter asking essentially to have like a six-month pause on the development of artificial intelligence. And you didn't sign that. How come?
I thought it was completely unrealistic. The point is, these digital intelligences are going to be tremendously useful for things like medicine, for reading scans rapidly and accurately. It's been slightly slower than I expected, but it's coming. They're going to be tremendously useful for designing new nanomaterials so we can make more efficient solar cells, for example. They're going to be tremendously useful, they already are, for predicting floods and earthquakes and getting better weather predictions. They're going to be tremendously useful in understanding climate change. So they're going to be developed. There's no way that's going to be stopped. So I thought it was maybe a sensible way of getting media attention, but it wasn't a sensible thing to ask for. It just wasn't feasible. What we should be asking for is that comparable resources are put into dealing with the bad possible side effects and dealing with how we keep these things under control as are put into developing them. So at present, sort of 99% of the money is going into developing them and 1% is going into sort of people saying, oh, these things might be dangerous. It should be more like 50-50, I believe.
When you kind of look back at the body of work of your life and when you look forward at what might be coming, are you optimistic that we'll be able as humanity to rise to this challenge, or are you less so?
I think we're entering a time of huge uncertainty. I think one would be foolish to be either optimistic or pessimistic. We just don't know what's going to happen. The best we can do is say, let's put a lot of effort into trying to ensure that whatever happens is as good as it could have been. It's possible that there's no way we will control these superintelligences and that humanity is just a passing phase in the evolution of intelligence, that in a few hundred years' time, there won't be any people. It'll all be digital intelligences. That's possible. We just don't know. Predicting the future is a bit like looking into fog. You know how when you look into fog, you can see about 100 yards very clearly, and then 200 yards, you can't see anything. There's a kind of wall. And I think that wall's at about 5 years.
Geoffrey Hinton, thanks so much for your time.
Thank you for inviting me.